Stuart, how's everyone doing today? Good. All right. All right. We got some energy. Thank you for that. Thank you. I'll try to give it back. Bless the Lord. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, I worship His holy name. My time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. You sing it.
Would you join me in a time of prayer and then we're going to get started. Father, we're grateful to be in Your house today for a time of celebration, to be here to celebrate Your grace and Your goodness and Your mercy and Your love. We're grateful, Father God, that you have brought together about 40-some-odd teenagers to plug into our church for the weekend, and they've engaged in a variety of different things and service projects and learning and worship and discipleship and fun. We're grateful, Father God, for the privilege that we have to be a blessing to our students. Father, we're also grateful for the privilege that we have to be a blessing to the least of these in our community. Father, Elvis very rarely darkened the doors of this church on a Sunday morning, but frequently he came through the doors of our church on a regular basis during the week. Father, our community is a little bit weaker because of his loss and because of his passing, but I am grateful to be a part of a church that reached out and loved this man and cared for this man during some hard days in his life. Father, we gather together today to worship you and to celebrate and to engage you in a variety of ways. And part of our responsibility is to come together as the body of Christ and pray for those who are going through a tough spot. And today, Father, my specific prayer is for our sweet friend Hattie, that you, God, would be gracious and merciful and give her healing and just calm her nerves as she gets ready for surgery on Wednesday. But we also come together as the body of Christ and we celebrate good things. And we celebrate with Justin, Katrina, and the safe arrival of this precious little girl, Hadley. Father God, you are good to us. You are gracious and you are merciful. And we are here to say thank you. And we want to honor you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you for this time that you've given us. Thank you for this time to worship. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen. This time I'm going to invite Curtis to make his way up here. Curtis, come on up. We have a handheld microphone he can use real quick. He's got it. Good deal. When Veronica and I moved here a few months ago, 18 months ago now, then the first time that Wired led worship, this young man sat behind me on my right, and he stayed back there, and he led and played the guitar and did his thing, and I thought at that point he might have been one of the shyest kids I've ever seen. And since that point, Curtis has come out and has done all kinds of things with our youth group and different things with our Wired team. When he leads worship on Sunday and Wednesday nights, he does a really neat job. And I wanted Curtis to kind of tell you a little bit about what they've done this week with DNOW. Curtis, give us a little rundown of what DNOW is.
Yes, so DNOW is like a weekend getaway where you can just go hang out and you don't have to worry about anything that you have to do next week, like my Spanish test on Wednesday.
You have a Spanish test on Wednesday?
Yeah, maybe.
¿Necesita practicar tu español por el último parte de este interview?
Okay.
No, okay. Okay, we're going to stop. We're going to stop right there. Tell us a little bit about your DNOW weekend, but you tell us a little bit about your service projects.
Yeah, so the service project, we went across the street to a church member's house, and we just raked up the yard, cut vines. And I should also mention, we took that time to prank the high school girls. We stuck sticky notes all over the
car. Oh, you took that time to prank the high school girls. That's very important to do. That's very important.
It was April Fool's, so we couldn't help it.
Okay, very good. Now, did you guys stay at somebody's house, or did you stay at the Holiday Inn, or where'd you stay?
We stayed at the Supan's house.
You stayed at the Supan's house. Very nice. Was Tom nice to you?
No.
No, he was not. Okay. That's to be expected. That's to be expected. Tell us a little bit about worship. The worship experience. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, so Miss Janelle got a guy named Stephen Authors to come over. He's from another church. And it was great. Last night, there's nothing like looking out, because I was playing. He asked me to play. There's nothing like looking out and watching a bunch of teenagers worshiping with all their heart. So it's pretty awesome. Yeah.
Very cool. Now, we had a special guest speaker, and her name is Jordana Ayler. And Jordana, are you in here? Or is she still? Jordana, did you make your way up here? Can you tell me one takeaway, one thing that you can remember that you're going to hold on to from what Jordana said during a speaking engagement?
Yeah, so she said a lot of stuff, and a lot of it I was like, oh, my heart. That's right there. But she also, one thing that's going to stick with me is that she said it's never too early to change the world.
It's never too early to change the world.
You know, I have tons of excuses and stuff, but, you know, they don't count for
anything. Very good. Very cool. That's a good word. It's never too early to change the world. That's a good word for all of us to hear. Jordana, would you make your way up here real quick? Some of you may remember Jim Ayler. He spoke here, and he was the interim minister for about 6 months when he was with us. Jim Ayler, his daughter-in-law, Jordana, she's been a friend of mine for about 10 years. She's done a variety of different things in her life. She's done a lot of cool stuff. And her next cool thing that she's going to be doing is she's going to be working here. She's going to start working with us. This summer, she's going to be our youth director, and when Mike retires, she's going to be our missions director. Jordana has worked with students all over, literally all over the world, and it's an exciting opportunity for her to come in and plug in with us, and we're awfully excited about Jordana getting ready to start with us, and you will see more of her, and you'll get some more information from her very soon in some emails and some videos. And so I just want to introduce Jordana, and I wanted to say thank you to Curtis for coming up.
So I was thinking this week, as I was preparing to leave, there's a thing that I do, and I don't know if the rest of you all do this. I've liked music for a long time, that may be obvious. But one thing that I still do that I've done as long as I can remember is occasionally I'll just go sit in front of my stereo and I'll put on a song, whatever the song is, or an album. Sometimes I do soundtracks, sometimes I listen to Mozart, sometimes whatever it is. But I know if you've done this in a while, have you ever sat on your couch or wherever it is, maybe dim the lights, maybe put on a candle, and maybe listen to the music, and just really be there and listen to it. So whatever that music is that moves you, there's something about it. There's something about just focusing only on the music. Listening in your car is great, but obviously there's a lot of things going on. There's just something about that. So I think sometimes for me, that's what worship is in the morning, because there may be a bunch of us here this morning. But I'll tell you a secret. When I play in front of you guys, mostly I ignore you. Mostly I'm just sort of like, I'm just going to do my thing. So I hope that you can maybe have a little bit of that yourself this morning. Maybe just ignore whoever's around. You're all dressed the same, so maybe that'll be hard over here. But if you just sort of, you know, ignore that and just hear whatever God is saying to you, whatever this song is saying to you. Whatever it is, that doesn't mean you can't stand up and sing with everyone, but whatever works for you this morning, let's try to do that together.
it never runs out on me. Well, your love.
Oh, sing it out now. I'm just kind of speechless. That song, if you know the history of the song and the man who wrote that song, it is a song of hope. And if you don't know it, go look it up. And we all tell the story of how he lost his family, but things that happened before and after that, it is amazing that this man could sit down and write that song. But that's what we have, is that hope. Come to the table of hope is what we're going to be talking about today. When we started the series, this chorus kept going in my head. So I just kind of wrote it down, and I sent it to Kim, who's so awesome. And I said, I need you to write a song. So she's like, when do you want it? I'm like, right now. So she wrote it. She finished it up. I don't even really know the tune, but because I kept trying to hum it to her, and I could never do the same thing twice. So she said, I'm just going to write it myself. And so she did. And so for our offering this morning, Kim is going to bless us with a song that just kind of sums up our Come to the Table series. This will be our offering time.
Come to the table, God's table. Take your place. Hope and redemption are waiting for you when you open your invitation to God's table.
Taste his grace.
That's pretty impressive stuff, Kim. Thank you very much. We appreciate you sharing that with us. Well, guys, I don't know if you're aware, but last Sunday I was out with the flu. Have not had the flu in a long time. Have not felt as poorly as I felt like that in a long time. And today I feel fine. I don't want to cough on you or anything of that nature, but I feel as weak as a kitten. So nobody fight with me today because I got no energy. And so that might be a trouble. And so anyhow, today we're going to wrap up our message series about coming to the table. And I want us to think about this idea of coming to the table of hope. Today we're going to take communion at the conclusion of my message series. At the conclusion of my message, I had a little lady ask me, kind of very quiet, she said, "Pastor, why aren't we doing communion during this series on coming to the table?" And I said, "We are at the very last one." So today, we're going to take communion, and we're going to talk about the beauty of hope. I've talked with you about many different people who've responded to some of my messages and significant tables in their lives, and I wanted to tell you a quick story about a table in my family's life. My parents did not travel at all. My parents just never, ever went anywhere. It's just the way it was. When I went to college in Missouri, I was there for 4 years. They came to see me one time. Maybe I was a bad kid. I don't know. And when Veronica and I got married, we moved to Fort Worth, Texas. We lived in Texas for 5 years, and my parents came to see us one time, just one time. They just did not travel. It just wasn't something that they did. And on the one time that they made it, my dad loved barbecue, and we went to this place in Fort Worth, Texas. And if you're from Texas, you might have heard of this place. It's called Coulter's Barbecue. Have great barbecue. And when we went there, my dad, who can make a mean barbecue on the grill, he loved the barbecue that they had. And when he finished, he did something that kind of embarrassed me, but he went to everybody in the wait staff and told them how great of their service was and how nice they were and how good they were. Then he went into the kitchen, and started talking to all the wait staff, all the cooks, and he told the cooks how much he loved their barbecue and how awesome the barbecue was. Then he found the manager, and he started talking to the manager, and by this point, I just want to crawl under the table. I was like, "Dad, don't come back and see us." But anyway, he was talking to the manager and telling the manager how much he loved the barbecue and how awesome the restaurant was and how much he loved this. And by the time he left, my dad figured out that this guy had a connection to Southern Illinois, and so they were best buds by the time we left. I guess I get a little bit from my father. But anyway, we go back and we leave, and my dad's there. My mom and dad are in Fort Worth for 4 days, and I think we visited that restaurant twice in 4 days because he really liked that barbecue. A couple months later, Thanksgiving break, my father goes in the hospital with COPD, his very first time, and his struggle with respiratory distress. And Veronica and I are getting ready to drive up to Southern Illinois from Fort Worth. It's about a 12 or 13 hour drive. And I went by that restaurant and I talked to the manager and I said, "Buddy," I said, "you remember my father?" And he says, "Oh yeah, how's your dad doing?" And I said, "Well, my dad's in the hospital." And I said, "Is there any way that we can take some barbecue back to him, take it to him in the hospital?" And he said, "What time are you leaving?" And I said, "Well, man, we leave about 3 a.m. And he said, "You show up here before you leave, and I'll have something for you." And I said, "Buddy, we leave at 3 a.m. He said, "Somebody will be here to give you your barbecue." So sure enough, I drove to that restaurant, and they had a styrofoam cooler. And I had no idea how much barbecue was in there, but when I picked it up, it probably weighed 15 pounds of barbecue that this guy had packed up, wrapped up, and stacked into that place, that cooler. And Veronica and I drove 700, 800 miles, 900 miles, I don't remember. Got there about dinner time on Thanksgiving Day. And when we walked into the hospital, I marched into the hospital carrying this cooler of I don't know what. And I open it up. And when I opened up all the tin foil, this steam, this wonderful barbecue steam just starts pouring out of this in my dad's hospital room, and all of a sudden nurses start coming into my dad's room, and then orderlies start coming to my dad's room, and then people who are in other hospital rooms start coming to my dad's room, and my dad's room is full, and my dad's smile is just getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And this fella had packed probably 10 pounds of brisket and pulled pork and barbecue ribs and all the best barbecue can you imagine. I know many of you are going to go have barbecue for lunch now. But as he opened all this up, then there were the fixings and all this, and the nurses started bringing in plates, and we had the best Thanksgiving feast in my dad's hospital room, and it was one of the best Thanksgiving meals that we could ever imagine. My father did not do well after that event. He just continued a big decline, but that was a huge day for my dad. It was a beautiful day for my dad, and it was a beautiful time of hope as we celebrated life. as we celebrated the beauty of life. And it's a one that gives great, great memory and great joy for me to think about. When we talk about coming to the table of hope, I shared with you in the very first message of this series that if we were to sum up the Old Testament and the New Testament in three expressions, we could sum up the Old Testament like this. They tried to kill us. We survived. Let's eat. And in the New Testament, we could sum it up in this expression, in these expressions. I love you. I forgive you. Let's eat. And as we prepare to take communion in just a few moments, we're going to be tying the Passover. They tried to kill us. We survived. Let's eat. We're going to be tying that in the communion table. And then we're also going to be tying the idea of I love you. I forgive you. Let's eat in this idea of coming to the table of Jesus. When we talk about coming to the table and coming to the table with Jesus, it's a reminder of the many times that Jesus sat with various people and heard their story and listened to what's going on with their lives and dialogued with them and engaged them. And he talked to his disciples, he talked to his friends, he talked to the broken and he talked to the busted. He talked to all kinds of people that were going through various travails in life. Jesus met them at the table and engaged in their story. One of the challenges that I gave you in my very first message was to look at your phone and find a friend who's going through a difficult season and encouraged you to invite them to church and take them to lunch and listen to their story and listen to what's going on and engage them in what their story might be. Coming to the table, sitting at the table, is a significant piece of our faith story. And in fact, I've got a person who's going to come up and tell us a little bit about her faith story at the table. Sally Hagenhoff, would you make your way up here, please? When Veronica and I met Stan and her wonderful husband, Sally and her wonderful husband, Stan, excuse me, I found out that they were from Cincinnati, Ohio. And Cincinnati, Ohio is famous for one thing at the table. And what was it that I asked you if you made?
Chili Mac.
Chili Mac. And if you've ever been to Cincinnati, they do fabulous Chili Mac. And this lady right here, she makes really good Chili Mac. You need to get an invitation to her house. We had a good conversation at that time, and she told me about something in their home that I thought was pretty cool. Can you tell everybody about the table that you had?
Well, we have had many tables. It started back when the kids were in middle school and high school. And I realized that many of the youth didn't know what a family dinner was. So on Sunday, we had dinner at noon, and we started inviting youth, and that was the beginning of our table.
Now, you specifically had a table that would seat how many people?
When we moved to Manassas, we had a table that had been in Stan's family, and it could seat 17. And I loved, loved, loved that table. And once again, we would invite the youth. We're now young adults, and they would invite their friends for various occasions, and we would fill that table.
Now, when you filled that table, how many times a year would you fill that table up? Would you fill it once a year? Would you fill it twice a year? Was that something you did quite a bit?
I couldn't tell you how many times we filled that table, but I remember one Easter when the grandchildren had invited friends. Some were Christians, some were not, and we had a tradition of the resurrection eggs. And we would pass that around the table, and if you chose an egg, you had to give the Christian symbol that was in that. If you didn't want to, that was okay. So that was one of our Easter things.
Now, I got to tell you, when I was asking her that question, somebody right over here said they filled that table every Sunday. And I'm guessing you went to that table and you had some time many times is what she's saying. Mm-hmm. And I thought, that's pretty cool. I wasn't even anticipating that, but that's kind of neat. And so one of the things, when you got rid of this table, you did something I thought it was heartbreaking, but it's a really cool story. What did you do underneath your table?
Well, when we moved to our condo, there was no room for this big table. And I dearly loved this table. And I would go sit underneath the table and tell stories when the little guys were little. And so we all gathered under the table. Yes, I did too. And we read one more story. And then I said, everybody has to write your name underneath the table. Well, of course, Stan thought that was ridiculous. And I said, that's okay. He said, but we're going to sell it. I said, that's okay. So we all got under the table and wrote our names, and somebody else wrote his name down.
I love that. I just think that is just the coolest thing ever. Now, if you go to their home now, and they still have, they've got a big table, and it would be crowded on this platform where we are. But when you would invite people to your home, and you'd sit around the table, who've offered the prayer every time you guys got ready to have a meal?
We invited our condo friends for dinner quite often. We would go to our place because it was the biggest, and we could sit 6 to 8, 10 if you really pushed it. And Stan would always give a blessing before we ate. Didn't make any difference, and they were very used to that, and they would just wait until he gave the blessing.
And after our friend's passing, something changed. Who started that?
After his passing, there was one gentleman that we dearly loved that lived, and he was always at our food things, and I told him he needed to sit in Stan's place. And he looked at me kind of funny, and I said, no, I want you to sit there. So when we got ready to eat, he asked the blessing, and he has been doing that ever since. And when I go to his house, he asks the blessing.
So that's not something that he was doing prior to your involvement.
No, was not.
And so when you see people coming to the table and seeing some of the beauty that's being passed along, not just for the children and the grandchildren, but also to other people who are fortunate enough to sit at the table with them. Sally, thank you. Could you give Sally a hand, please? All right. Well, if you have your Bibles, I'm going to invite you to open up to the Gospel of Mark, and we're going to be looking in the Gospel of Mark and talking about the coming to the table of Jesus when he came to the Passover meal. And we're going to be looking at this image in the Gospel of Mark in the 14th chapter in verse 12. And we're going to be talking about this idea of what the Passover looked like in that capacity. And so you can see the scripture behind me. If you've got it on your phones, you can open up on your phones. And if you can open it up in your Bibles, you're welcome to do that as well. I'm going to read those two verses for you real quick. On the first day of the Feast of the Unleavened Bread, when it was customary to sacrifice the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples asked him, where do you want us to go and prepare a meal for you for the Passover? So he sent two of his disciples, and he told them, go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. We read this, and we don't think anything significant about this, because simply, Jesus told the disciples, go into Jerusalem, find a place to eat, find this house, and he's going to take you, and he's going to give you your place to go. But the fact of the matter is, Jerusalem is full of people looking to have the Passover meal. Jerusalem is full of thousands upon thousands of pilgrims who've arrived in the city for this exact purpose. And on the night that Jesus is doing this, this is kind of a big request. On that night, Jesus saying to the disciples, go in and you're going to find this and get ready to take part in this. When we think about the Passover, many of us simply consider that it's just bread and juice because of what we have done through the years of our engagement with communion. But when you were to consider what Passover was like for our Jewish friends and what they would take, there are multiple elements of that. The bread in that plate that you're looking at, that bread is called matzo bread, and it's like a cracker, if you will. That's why our bread in the communion is very similar to that cracker. But there are other elements around that plate. And I want to go over with you real quick what those elements look like and what those elements are, because they are very significant for our Jewish friends and what that looks like. One of those bowls has what they call bitter herbs. The bitter herbs were given so that the people would remember the bitterness of life when they were in Egypt. Those bitter herbs are horseradish. And part of taking the element of the Passover was taking the bitter herb and remembering how bitter life was. A second element of that would have been a paste, a sweet paste made of sugar and made of figs. And this sweet paste was a symbolic of the mortar that they used in making the bricks to build the pyramids. And as the Jewish families would take this element, they would remember the work that they did in preparing the pyramids in Egypt. The third element was a vegetable. Sometimes that vegetable might have been a celery, sometimes it might have been a broccoli, sometimes it would have been another type of vegetable that you would dip into a bowl of salt water. It wasn't necessarily about the vegetable. The symbolism was dipping the vegetable into the salt water, and when you lifted up the vegetable and the salt water dripped off, That was symbolic of the tears that fell from Egypt for the abuse and the hurt that the Israelites suffered for 400 years. The next element was a shank of lamb, was a piece of lamb as it symbolized the Paschal lamb that was sacrificed. The fifth element was a boiled egg, the egg symbolizing mourning. I didn't know this, but that's why we serve deviled eggs at funerals, is because an egg is a symbol of sorrow. It's a symbol of mourning. I just like deviled eggs. But anyway, another element they had was the wine. When Jesus tells the disciples, he told the disciples, say to the owner of the house, the teacher asks, where is my guest room? Where may I eat the Passover with my disciples? And he'll show you a large upper room, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us to go there. The Passover meal is not a meal that you eat quick. The Passover meal is a meal that's going to take about 3 to 3.5 hours to work your way through the meal. Each element is a time of remembrance, and you discuss each portion and each element of what that meal represents, what the egg represents, what the horseradish represents, what the salt water represents. And there was a multiple discussion that would go along with that as the family would teach the children and they would remember their faith story. So when Jesus comes to the table and says to the disciples, I want to have this meal and I want to have this together, this is a pretty significant event that's taking place over a long time. When Veronica and I were in Tappahannock, we had a lady in our congregation. Her name was Bonnie Cohen. Bonnie Cohen arrived in Tappahannock about the same time we did. She retired from Northern Virginia into Tappahannock. By her last name, you might be able to tell that Bonnie was Jewish. In fact, she wasn't just Jewish, she was an Orthodox Jew. In fact, she was the only Jewish person who lived in Tappahannock that we knew of. For some reason, Bonnie connected to our congregation. And when Bonnie connected to our congregation, she started coming to church. And Bonnie would sing the hymns. And when she would sing the hymns, she would sing out until we got to the name of Jesus, and she just wouldn't sing the name of Jesus. And so Bonnie was a very active part of our church on Wednesday nights and Sunday mornings. And about 2 or 3 months into her engagement, she called me and she said, Pastor, I need to talk to you. And I said, okay, Bonnie, let's talk. And she said, David, I've got a problem. And I said, Bonnie, what's your problem? She said, I like your church. I said, Bonnie, what's the problem? I'm a Jew. I said, Bonnie, that's not a problem. She said, oh yeah, that's a problem. I said, Bonnie, what's the problem? I'm a Jew. What's the problem, Bonnie? I like your church. Bonnie, I don't see what the problem is. David, I'm a Jew. Don't you see what the problem is? And I said, Bonnie, no, I really don't see what the problem is. And she went on and talked about her family, and she talked about her father, and she talked about her siblings, and she talked about her children. She said, my kids, my family, my parents, they just wouldn't understand this. I love this church, and I love being a part of this, but I don't think it's right for me to come here. And I said, Bonnie, why? David, I'm a Jew. And I said, Bonnie, I got to tell you something. You might have landed in the only church in Virginia that I'm aware where the pastor's wife is Jewish. She looked at me and her eyes got real big and she said, what are you talking about? And I said, Veronica's grandmother just passed away in Mexico. She's the only blonde Mexican that I knew. Her name was Grawiowski. She was Polish and she was Jewish and she immigrated to Mexico in the 1915, 1916. And she looked at me with eyes real wide and she said, you can't be serious. I said, oh yes, I am serious. And so Bonnie began a journey with us that was absolutely fascinating. I invited Bonnie to do the Passover meal for us so that we could have a Passover meal on a Wednesday night. Bonnie said, David, it's going to take 3.5 hours for us to do that. And I said, Bonnie, there's not a Baptist I know that can sit still for 3.5 hours to do that. And she said, well, David, we've got to do it in 3 to 3.5 hours. I said, can you cut it down to an hour? And she said, no. I said, okay. So we were not able to do the Passover meal. So Jesus, when he tells the disciples this picture and presents this idea of going and preparing the meal, you've got to understand, it's not a quick little ham sandwich. It's not, that's terrible. It's not a quick little turkey sandwich. It's not a hamburger. It's not, that was just bad. I do not know why that came out, but I'm sorry. That was just bad. It wasn't going to be something fast. It was going to be something involved and detailed and all of that. And so Jesus calls the disciples together. And when they get ready to break bread, the scripture goes on and it says something profound. When evening came, Jesus arrived with the 12, and they were reclining at the table eating. He said, I tell you the truth, one of you is going to betray me, one of you who's eating with me. And they were saddened, and one by one they said to him, surely not I. For 3 years, the disciples have have struggled with the idea of what is getting ready to happen. They've watched the miraculous. They've seen Jesus heal the dead. They've seen Jesus put eyes in blind people. They've seen Jesus feed the multitudes. And they've heard Jesus talk about this arrest, this crucifixion, the death. And the disciples can't understand this. They've seen unbelievable things. And Jesus has told them all along the journey that this arrest, this betrayal, this crucifixion, the death is getting ready to happen. And the disciples can't understand it. So when Jesus tells them that one of you is going to betray me tonight, they're still not computing what is fully getting ready to happen. And when Jesus says one of you is going to deny me tonight, no, it's not going to be me. It's not going to happen. Now, you've been at this dinner table. You were there when your dad said, hey guys, I got some news for you. We've got to move. My job's changed. You were at the dinner table when your parents said, hey, we got some news we've got to tell you. Grandma's sick and it's not going to end well. You were at the dinner table when your mom said, your dad and I are having some problems and we're going to split up, but you're going to be okay. You were at the dinner table when somebody told you they lost their job and that things were going to get different. You were at that dinner table. That dinner table's tough too. It's hard to wrap our brain around and hard to kind of come to grips with the fact of who we are and where we are and what's going on. And Jesus says this to these disciples and they're not grasping what's getting ready to take place. And in fact, the scripture goes on that while they were eating a little bit later, Jesus took the bread and he gave thanks for it and he broke it and he said, take this, this is my body. And a little bit later, it goes on that he said in verse 23, then he took the cup and he gave thanks and he offered it to them and they drank from it. And he said, this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Again, the disciples are thinking, what is he talking about? What does he mean? He goes on a little bit more. And he says, I tell you the truth. I'm not going to drink of it again until that day when I drink it anew in the kingdom of God. And when they'd sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. This image of the coming to the table with Jesus is one that has resonated with people for millennia. We look at Jesus telling this story and engaging with the disciples and doing this, and we can see in the very earliest paintings of our Christian faith in the catacombs of Rome, this table depicted. We can see in the most famous painting in all of human history, Leonardo da Vinci and his depiction of the Last Supper, and you see in that image before you this the wonder of what this moment signifies. That painting that you look at before you, that painting was painted in an alcove of a building. It literally was falling apart within 50 years. The paint was falling off of it. They didn't think it was going to survive, so they literally put a brick wall over the front of it. And then at some point, they cut a hole through the middle of it. And yet we look at that painting and we recognize the significance of God sitting at a table with us. We see this painting from the 1400s, again of a fella who's depicting the significance of the moment of Jesus instituting what he did in the Lord's Supper. We see this painting time and time again. This one is in the bottom of a Polish salt mine. It's about 400 years old, and it's made just of salt, again, a copy of Da Vinci's Last Supper. There is something profound and significant in the fact that God chose to come to the table and institute something new and something sacred and something profound and something that changed the whole concept of how we understand and who he seems to be. The disciples are still at this point not understanding what's getting ready to happen with the arrest and the beating and the crucifixion and the resurrection. They are not fully cognizant of everything that is getting ready to take place, and they only look back at this moment and go, oh my God. That's what he meant. That's what he said. That's what was going on. That's why we can read with the Apostle Paul from 1 Corinthians. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup and said, this cup, it's the new covenant of my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you drink this cup and you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes, this new covenant, whenever you do this, you're proclaiming his death until he comes again. It's a reminder. It's a reminder of your forgiveness. It's a reminder of your restoration. It's a reminder of your redemption. It's a reminder that you and I are sinful, broken, people in desperate need of a Savior. This cup and this bread, it's a reminder of the arrest and the betrayal and the beating and the death. But this cup and this bread, it's also an image of hope that the grave couldn't hold him, that the grave didn't win, that death wasn't victorious, that there is power in the name of Jesus. There's power in the hope that he provides. For some of us, we take this communion time. It means a variety of different things. Many of us come from a Catholic background, and in our Catholic background, we look at this as a miraculous moment. In the Catholic tradition, they believe in a concept called transubstantiation, which means that when the priest prays over the bread and prays over the cup, that bread and that cup, they miraculously become the body and the blood of Jesus, that you are actually eating Jesus' body and flesh. Our Lutheran friends, they believe in a concept called consubstantiation, where there's something spiritual that takes place, and that the bread and the blood and the body and come together, and they become and they coexist in a supernatural way. In our tradition, we consider the Lord's Supper an ordinance. What that means? That means that this is a command. Jesus tells us to take this, to do this, that this is a time to remember. This is a time to symbolically take the body and to take the blood. It's a time when we connect, when we evaluate, when we consider who we are and what we are in our faith journey. That's what these elements signify for us. As Baptists, we believe in two ordinances, one being communion, the second being baptism. Those are our two biggies, if you will. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, in verse 27, the Apostle Paul says, "Therefore, whoever eats of this bread or drinks of the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner, he'll be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and he drinks the cup." Today, when you take the cup, you're going to receive two cups. One's going to have juice and the other one's going to have a piece of bread. And this is the time when you can do some introspection that I can never do for you. This is a time when you can evaluate your story and your faith and your hope and your journey. This is a time when you can evaluate who you are and what you are and reflect on the steps that you've taken. This may be a time that you need to address repentance and renewal. I don't know what it is for you, but I know that when we take this cup and we take this bread, it's an opportunity for us to connect once again with the hope that Jesus provides, with the promise of redemption and restoration and renewal. That's what this cup and this bread signify for us, the hope that Jesus gives on that cross. Guys, there's not a perfect person in this room, but it's a time for us to reflect and consider our faith story as we take next steps. At this time, I'm going to close in a word of prayer. Then I'm going to ask the deacons to come and prepare. And as you receive the elements that are going to come by, there's going to be two cups in one. I want you to take one. And you will take them both. And you will hold the bread in one cup and hold the juice in the other cup. And it'll be a time for us to reflect as I lead us forward. Father, we are grateful for this time that we have. We are grateful, Father God, that you've invited us to the table of hope. That, Father, when we come to the table of hope, we understand that we are broken. We understand that we've fallen. We understand where we've been. And, Father, we understand, God, that it is only by your grace and mercy that we find that we are your children, children of God. Father, we are grateful for the work that Jesus did. And as we prepare to take this cup and prepare to take this bread, we are reminding ourselves of the call that you made to us that we answered, that we said, yes, we want to follow Jesus. Yes, we want to honor Jesus. And we ask, God, that you would speak to our hearts now as we prepare to take it. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Why are you striving these days? Why are you trying to earn grace? Why are you crying? Let me lift up your face. Just don't turn away. Why are you looking for love? Why are you still searching as if I'm not enough? To where will you go, child? Tell me, where will you run? To where will you run? 'Cause I'll be by your side whenever you fall in the dead of night. Whenever you call, and please don't fight these hands that are holding you. My hands are holding you. Look at these hands and my side. They swallowed the grave on that night. When I drank the world's sin so I could carry you in and give you life. I wanna give you life. I'll be by your side whenever you fall in the dead of night. Whenever you call, and please don't fight these hands that are holding you. And my hands are holding you here at my side. Wherever you fall in the dead of night. Whenever you call, and please don't fight these hands that are holding you.
Separate the cups. And the cup that has the wafer, would you take a wafer? Would you hold that in your hands as I pray? Father, we are holding this little white wafer. It's symbolic, Father God, of the body of Jesus. It's a reminder to us of what Jesus endured on our behalf. And Father, as we hold this as individuals who look and evaluate our own story, our own faith, our own walk in light of our commitment to you. And Father, it's a reminder of our brokenness. It's a reminder of our desperate need. It's a reminder, Father, of your grace and your mercy and the fact that you loved us. That table that you invited your disciples to and Da Vinci depicted, Father God, the fascinating piece of that is that you chose to have a relationship with them and you choose to have a relationship with us. There's nothing magical or sacred in this bread, but there is something very significant in this bread, as it is a reminder of the fact that Jesus wants to walk with us today. And when we hold this, when we take this, we are proclaiming the hope that He's coming back, and that we are reminded of our call to live for Him and honor Him. So Father, we take this bread and we say thank You for Your sacrifice. In Jesus' name. You take the cup. Join me as we pray. Father God, we hold the cup now. The cup symbolizing the blood of Christ that was spilled at Calvary's cross. The cup that symbolizes the blood of the Lamb that takes away the sins of the world. Father, Your word teaches us over and again that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. And Father, we recognize with John the Baptist that Jesus indeed was the Paschal Lamb that takes away the sins of the world. And Father God, we recognize as we look at our own reflection that we need You, that we are broken people, that we are in desperate need of grace and mercy. And this cup symbolizes the fact of Your redemption for us. And so, Father God, we recognize that it is symbolic of the new covenant that Jesus established at Calvary. And it's a reminder for us to walk in the newness of life that You provide. We say thank You for what the cup means and how we can honor You with our lives. It's in Jesus' name we pray.
There's better days still up ahead, even after You're my hope. Have a good week, everyone.